Hello and welcome to Let's Play Scratches, Director's Cut. Happy Halloween! I am Amethyst Lunatari. I normally don't play scary games like this, but this is like an adventure game, so I'm hoping... I don't know about jump scares or not. I think it's more the atmosphere. But no spoilers, please. I am playing this blind. I only looked over the two rooms and the outside areas, which couldn't get anywhere. And yeah, I guess hopefully nothing's chasing me because I hate that. But I don't think it's that kind of game. Anyway, this was released all the way back with the original in 2006, and then the director's cut in 2007 from Nucleosys, who put out one other game and since folded. But Augustine Cordes has one of the founders. He is now at Senscape working on a game called Asylum for the last 10 years. I mean, I love him, but put out the game already. I played the demo a little while ago, so you can look that up on my channel if you want to. So thrilled about that, I wanted to play Scratches. I wanted to scratch my itch, as it were. So, this is a couple notes. This is running in 1024 by 768. From what I hear, the game doesn't work correctly otherwise if you choose some other resolution, or if you try to force it into another resolution. So, I have to play it in that, and then in order to get it to behave correctly on YouTube, I have to then render it the footage in 1280 by 720. So, hopefully, it looks okay to you guys. The setup. Hints on. Your character says more if you have hints on. It's recommended you have them on. Surround music. I don't really know if that makes a difference. Camera speed. This was stuff the hints I found on the interwebs. Recommend the camera speed should be slow, otherwise you're all over the place. Text speed, I guess, normal. Slideshow mode off. Alternate control should be disabled. Gamma correction. Low, medium, high. Wow. How about low? Because I know things get darker on YouTube, and this is... Oh wait, that's not it. That looks bad, and that looks washed out to me. And this looks rather dark, so let's put it on low. There's no real recommendation on that. Anyway. You guys already saw the intro, so we'll skip past that. Alright. So with the director's cut, I think this was added the last visit, so I'll be playing this afterwards, kind of like a DLC kind of thing. It's funny because I have the actual... I'm playing... Well, I installed it from a DVD-ROM. You can find it on... You can find this game on Steam. But you can't buy it. I think it's a licensing issue. So, I went on... I forget which... Either eBay or Amazon and bought it, so... Because I want to play it and I don't like when things get denied me, so... Director's cut. Saturday, October 12th, so here we begin. And I'm going to read all the text, so... The cloudy sky above me seemed rather unsettling and almost made me lose my balance. I felt a curious urge to run for shelter, and my new home in the distance seemed very inviting. I don't think it's going to be inviting for long. So here's our car. Here's the gate. Surely I could left-click to move around whenever my finger was pointing forwards. Even if I wanted to leave, I could not do so. On foot. Hopefully you guys don't mind me reading everything. There is some voiced stuff. The mailbox was empty. And then to get out, you go like that. From what I've seen, Asylum is going to be much the same. My magnifying glass would allow me to examine an object with a left click. See, these are the items we have. That's our journal. Just empty. Wait a second. It was my journal. It was the key Jerry gave me to Blackwood Manor. The suitcase was holding some of my stuff. It was awfully heavy. My loyal typewriter was inside that case. It was the car starter. Guess what part of the car that is. So we got the car keys. Now I could put these car keys in here, but he won't leave. He says something it's silly to leave after coming all the way out here or something like that. And I want to hold on to the car keys. When I was testing this before, I couldn't get the keys back out. They go here. The key to my trusty car, so I'd rather keep the keys with me. So, we have some places we can go outside. Logic dictated that I could use or grab an object with a left click when my hand was grasping. Indeed. A hefty lock was preventing my entry to the garage. There's no way I can open it with my bare hands. And, while looking closely at a certain object, I realized I could go back with the left click when my hand was pointing downwards, yes. Oh, and we have to go out back out to the real world. The key didn't fit there. So, we got some barrels here. I guess it's just a fence. There's really not much to see here until we can get inside. I assume at some point we'll find a key. Car. The manor lies ahead. How do I get over there? I guess you have to go forward first. Interestingly enough, you can't examine any of this. Down this path. A lot of rocks. The door to the greenhouse was stuck, probably due to some serious rusting of its hinges. I almost succeeded, but in spite of my efforts, the door wouldn't budge. Now, it's not locked. So. Just can't get in. Kinda wonder. Doubt it. You can break the glass. That wasn't a proper place to leave the case. That wasn't the best spot to put the box, either. Alright, so... that's it for that, and there's this tree somewhere around here. Whoops. The only problem with this is that... the camera... when you have the, cursor at the edge, it tends to get stuck. So that's why you see me going like that. Is this where the tree is? No. Oh, it just goes back. Just want to show you guys that tree. That's the way back, I think, right? Right. A gray and naked tree was standing on a small knoll, crowning an otherwise bare area, with its thin branches slowly swaying in the gentle wind. All of a sudden, I began to feel very alone. The tree had a little hole in its base which allowed water to pass through from a nearby lake. There's a small pool of water below the arching tree. And that's that. I mean, I guess if we need water... I think we have to go one more screen. Oh, there's something else around this way. We're on the side of the house now. Oh god, I'm getting stuck. Get that, huh? The massive double doors leading to the interior of the chapel are locked. And just to prove to you guys, the key doesn't fit there. That way. Can't go that way. How do I get back? The only problem is going into these areas. It's not so easy to see how we got there. We're literally going through the branches there. Whoops. So there it is. Can't seem to look at anything here. Standing there in front of the door made me realize that I could right-click to open the inventory. Not really. The door to the house was locked, fortunately. I thought this place looked inviting to you. Changed your mind quickly, didn't you? Alright. Let's get the key. All of a sudden I had a gut feeling. With another right click I could close the inventory. Finally I concluded I could use the key, the on the door, with a left click to unlock it. I marveled at such a wondrous concept. With very little effort the key unlocked the front door. I'm guessing the tutorial stuff ends now. And here we are. There was a huge vase of oriental... Okay. My handy magnifying glass would also allow me to examine an item while in my inventory by using it on that item. I guess we have one more message. Oriental craftsmanship standing by the windows. I guess we better get the phone.
Hey, Jerry. It's good to hear your voice.
I see that piece of junk you got there is working.
My thoughts exactly. I was afraid it'd fall apart as soon as I laid my fingers on it.
So how did you find everything? Do you like the place?
It's hard to tell yet. I'm very impressed, that's for sure.
Just got in.
Sound odd. Is everything okay?
Yes, yes, yes. It's perfectly fine. It's just that I'm in awe. I mean, pleasantly surprised. This house is like a dream come true. I'm telling you, I'm going to turn this place into a factory of horror stories.
Good. You ought to finish that book. I'm rooting for you, mate. You sure everything is in order?
Well, I just got here. Let me have a look around, and I'll get back to you if I find anything strange.
Excellent. I'll talk to you later.
Famous last words, a factory of horror stories. Thought about calling Jerry, but I couldn't remember his number in London. Alright, so we'll look around a little bit more at stuff. Wild horses, couldn't keep them away. A We're looking at those, vases. A generic standard lamp. Still, it was elegant and tasteful. And off. I intended to brighten up the whole place, but to my surprise, the lights wouldn't work. I like to get to look at this artwork. Alright, so we got stairs up, which I'm not taking yet. I looked at the vase. It was a rather torn umbrella. The time was 9 o'clock a.m. Oof. From what I hear, if you... Okay. I can't stop it. If you achieve something, the time moves forward. It was just another ordinary vase. Alright, so let's check in here. I always wanted to be a pianist, but eventually found another use for my fingers. I'm getting stuck more than I was before. This is the other room that I looked at. A fancy red clock, which sadly wasn't functioning. The place was full of exquisite, albeit aged, candelabras. I've read that before. Oh. A picture or painting of casks. Now this is a little... I've never seen this picture. I wonder if it's an actual painting. Because it looks like he's about to kill this guy, but she's... Either she grabbed his arm, she's either trying to stop him, but then the way she's pointing, it's almost like she's directing him how to best go about killing this guy or stabbing him, slitting his throat, whatever. It was all gibberish to me. Same, my friend, same. Unfortunately, we can't open this or mess around with playing it. Just in case, I tried again, but still, there was no power. Church in a river, Venice or something. Now this I do recognize as half of the painting. An impressive fireplace, and surprisingly clean too, although it hasn't been used in a long time. The fireplace had a generous amount of wood in it, and I was relieved to know that I could warm the place up in case it got cold. I'm certainly not good at chopping trees. I'm better at using trees to write horror stories. Can I look at this? No. Okay. I wondered how long that cup of coffee had been sitting there. It looked as if an untidy person enjoyed reading in the living room. And here we go. April 20th. During a fit of rage, I burnt my previous diary. Not that I regret it. It's a little hard to read this. It's as if my disjointed notes were worth anything. Their only purpose was to keep me sane. I feel that this is my escape route. My only means of finding some inner peace. Whenever I put my pen to this paper, I feel that I can reflect upon my situation. I just wish I had more options, that's all. But I'm rambling. I must think clearly. Focus. May 12th. I've become an eternal guardian, stuck between few choices, none of which are good. Do I fulfill a promise and violate everything that I believe in the very principles of my life, or am I condemned to spend the rest of my existence in this dead-end state, a ghost with no other purpose than just being here, watching? I truly have no escape. I can't find an appropriate solution to this problem, and I must pay the price. I'm a shadow of the man I used to be. Only these notes remain, my testament in these moments of meditation, my sole companion. June 26th. Today I spent the entire afternoon staring at the window, my mind a blank. Oddly enough, I really didn't care. It seems now as though it was something natural for me, a part of my personality. But I know the reason very well. I've lost my soul. I'm an empty shell, devoid of any feelings. I renounced them on that fateful day, and the worst thing is I knew there were going to be consequences. No, that's not true. Consequences were far worse than I expected. How could I be so blind? January 23rd? 21st? With a TH? I'm not sure what that number's supposed to be. 23rd? It looks kind of like it could be a 3, chopped off a little at the top. I don't know. I often wonder what would have happened if we had simply reversed it all. What would happen if right now I came out and told the world what really happened? No, I'd end up rotting in jail. Although that might be a better destiny compared to this eternal suffering. November 17th. I can't say for sure when it began. I just heard them one morning, coming from next room. The whispers. Are they real? Have I been alone for too long? They won't stop. I can't stand it any longer. February 7th. Ever since I locked it away, that everything seems to have calmed down a bit. Perhaps James was right after all. It's madness, I know. But at this point, I'd be inclined to believe anything. May. No number. Over the years, I was convinced that everything James suffered was a misfortune, a whim of destiny. For the first time ever, I'm not so sure anymore. I never thought it could happen, but I believe I understand now. If this is so, then cursed be my soul. Poor James. If I had acted in another way, then maybe things would have worked out differently. But it's too late now. I have to suffer my Calvary. Suffer my Calvary? September 13th. The noises are back, although this time they're different. Before, I'd only heard them inside my head as if someone or something was whispering and, how to put this, interrupting my thoughts. But now, I can really feel them spreading around the house. What are they? September 14th, I think? I've realized the noises are coming from down there. I don't want to think about it anymore. December? They are unbearable. They get worse at night. Oh, how I wish it would stop. What is going on down there? I don't dare go nearer. I don't want to know. March? May. March turned into May. God, how many years have passed? I have lost all sense of time. I have to get out of this place. The diary disturbed me in a way I couldn't explain, yet I felt curious about what had been tormenting that poor fellow. I have a feeling we're gonna find that out. So this is the limits of where I've played. Everything from here on is blind. I actually didn't read the diary. We got a library in here. This place is full of exquisite albeit age of condolam resume. Guess that's a piece of a candelabra? Remnants of a previous fire. The stone in the fireplace was cold to the touch. Oh, stop. You're getting stuck. The glass was empty. Pity, I could have used a drink. Just a bunch of uninteresting books. That's a shame. I want only interesting books. Alright, so nothing else to look at here. No, smoking can kill you, especially when the cigars are decades old. Let's look at the desk last, I guess. Newfoundland, Portugal. Thought if I could switch it counterclockwise. The huge collection of books was impressive. I would have gladly spent days going through them. Several trophies for remarkable accomplishments adorned the room. Most of the clocks in the house weren't working. A diploma granting the title of construction engineer to James T. Blackwood. Well, that's what James was mentioned in that book. There's no book of interest that stands out amongst all these. Two years of East Africa, a journey to the sources of the Nile. With numerous illustrations. I can't get any description of anything here. More stuff to read. February 6th. The construction of the railway bridge is almost complete and went quite smoothly. It took longer than I expected, yet I wish it would have lasted longer. I'll be very sad to leave South Africa. I've become so attached to it, its culture, its arts, over the past few months, that I can't help feeling as if it was already a part of me. I will surely return some day. Soon, hopefully. Although I'm afraid there's a great deal of work to be taken care of back in old Britain. Fortunately, I made good friends here who are ecstatic about my new appreciation of their country. They have offered me some wonderful objects as a token of gratitude, which I have already crated and got ready to ship, along with many trinkets I bought myself. It looks like I'm about to start a very substantial collection. It's a good thing Catherine agreed to move into our new home, although I fear several renovations will have to be made, even more if I'm intending to start a serious new hobby. It seems I'll have to get back to work. John Patterson has just told me some natives are causing trouble, a very unfortunate thing, although I'm secretly rejoicing. Rejoicing. February 12th. The natives won't leave. It's not like they're causing trouble, quote-unquote, so much as they're unsettling our workers. The only complaint so far has been distraction. They just stand still between the trees staring at us without blinking an eye. I've watched them for a few minutes, and they truly seem like some tenebrous statues. At first, it was just annoying, but lately it's become downright creepy. They seem to be stalking us. So it's not like they're hindering the construction, but there is a general uneasy feeling, as if they're about to jump at us at any moment. I think I will hire some protection as a measure of precaution. February 15th. Fascinating. I've been looking into these natives. They live in a nearby village and are a very small group, yet they seem to manage quite well. I had thought of them as quite an uncivilized tribe, but their movements are calculated, and one can perceive a sense of careful organization in their tasks. Oddly enough, they seem to be very brutish, and their aspect looks awful, although I couldn't take a good look at their facial features, as I followed one of them completely on my own, and it could have been dangerous getting any closer. Also, the village is poor and very rough, but some of the shacks leapt out as inviting or special. It made me very curious. I will try to come closer tomorrow. February 16th. Right, so is this daily? February 6th. Well, then February 6th, then we jump to 12th, and then 15th, 16th, and 20th. My second expedition to the village of the natives has been foiled by an unexpected problem at the bridge. I'm afraid it was due to a slight miscalculation on my part, an indication that I should be focusing more on the task at hand and put my sudden love for all African things aside for a moment. It was my fault, and I accept it. Problem at the bridge. February 20th. They're at it again, lurking beyond the forest. It's amazing how they have changed our perception of the surroundings. At first we were delighted by the quiet nature of the place. Now we fear what horrors might be concealed in that dark and foreboding cloak of trees. The tops loom above us, overshadowing the bridge, and strange noises haunt our meals. Even the river telling ungodly secrets. We could be, of course, a bit more sensitive towards distractions, but I can't help feeling the area has in fact become more sinister. And yet I'm still looking forward to satisfying my curiosity about the tribe. Alright, so that was the 20th. Now the 24th. February 24th. At last I've found something more about the neighboring tribe. This is an incredible finding, and I just can't withhold my excitement. Some elders at the local town happen to know about them, but only through stories they heard. The most surprising thing is that the tribe was assumed to be extinct long ago, but according to my vague descriptions, the elders think that we could be dealing with a legend here. Everything they ever learned of them was during their childhood, when the tribe was stalking the town, much in the same way that they have been stalking us. People used to call them Dithom? Am I reading that right? D'THAUM? As much as such was the sound of screams heard echoing late in the night. They'd come out into the streets and see an evil glitter atop a hill in the distance. Some would say it was a fire, others the cursed spirit of an ancient god. Whatever it was, they say the bright light, amid their fantastic screams, was bone-chilling. The macabre scene would suddenly stop as if it had begun out of nowhere, never to be seen again in days to come. Intervals between these horrible nights became longer and longer until they soon faded into oblivion. The tribe apparently had retreated back into obscurity, until now. They were later known as the Dhalmaar, a rather more scientific name, although none of the people I spoke with could possibly remember its origin. I find it extremely surprising that nobody has ever heard about this tribe with the exception of a few townspeople. They must be incredibly rare, and judging by the stories passed on from generations in the town, very old. February 27th. I will confess that I become nearly obsessed with this strange tribe. I see them as the most prized goal of my appreciation towards all South African things, a dangerous yet irresistible reward. I feel as if they were my discovery. I simply have to study them before leaving. I fear I won't have the chance to ever again. It has become an important goal of mine, even more important than finishing the bridge. March 4th. Finally, I have managed to see them. My God, what a disturbing spectacle. When we arrived, they were moving around the village very slowly, without speaking or communicating with each other, each minding his or her own business, completely alien to the rest of the world. They were filthy looking, coarse and downright disgusting. I couldn't see any weapons, but they could have been stored somewhere. It was all very strange behavior in a tribe. They must be quite unique. Then, as if they had suddenly all become possessed by some wild spirit, they began shaking spasmodically and screaming like mad. Some of them dropped to their knees and lifted their heads to the sky, eyes blank, and moaning in an indescribable way. Two of them walked away, still in that monotonous and slow manner, and in great contrast to the rest of the scene, into a shack. The next minute, they brought out into the open an odd-looking mask. Its shapes, colors, and overall looks, while unsettling, were mesmerizing, and I felt instantly hypnotized by it. It rendered my modest collection of African curiosities into dull and uninteresting items. A mask, huh? The mask was very ominous, and the whole tribe seemed to greatly revere it. Soon they began to gather around it and move in circles, fluttering and chanting a guttural psalm. Judging by their emotions and aspects of the whole ritual, it must have been some kind of war ritual. I'm not sure how to explain what happened next, as I feel my pulse is already throbbing. Words fail me to recount the most disturbing thing I've ever witnessed. One of the male villagers walked into the middle, near the mask, by his own will. It was an almost automatic act. All of a sudden, the remaining members became silent. I can't tell for how long it lasted, but I was afraid to breathe. I think Dhalmaar, and the others were also scared. They wouldn't even blink. I remember being soaked wet and expectant. The silence was so unnatural. Then a few members separated from the people circling the mask and jumped on the single villager, beating him to death. To be completely faithful to the event, the small crowd tore him apart. They grabbed his legs in twos and threes and twisted them in a manner I dare not describe. His face was disfigured with their bare fingernails and teeth, and the torso soon disappeared under the frenzied tangle of hands. In a matter of a few minutes, the villager was turned into a red sack of bones. Not one of the attackers had the compassion to snap his neck during the sickening process. All was very methodical, as if it was just another mundane task. The most terrifying aspect, though, was that the victim didn't even cringe. The silence was so deep, I could hear his flesh ripping. I would expect any living creature to scream its guts out in such a fashion, such a condition. I can't tell whether he was drugged or half asleep, but I did recognize him dancing like everybody else before walking into the middle of the circle. It was the most outrageous and sadistic sacrifice I've ever heard of. I don't think I will ever forget what I saw. My intentions of approaching further, even if they didn't have any weapons at hand, vanished. These creatures, I dare not call them human beings, could have killed my whole company in the blink of an eye with their rage. They seemed to be completely out of themselves and willing to destroy anything intruding into their path. While the images of the sacrifices still haunt my thoughts, I still can't seem to forget that mask. A little paper covering here. It was so deceptively simple and yet perfect in its design. I haven't seen anything like it. I surely would love to take a better look. I feel that Dhalmaar, dangerous as they are, could be the most important ethnical finding in decades. What I've seen today is crying for some further investigating. I just can't leave them like that. I would never forgive myself. And the mask. That mask. I was ecstatic after reading the journal. The material was incredible. Wow. Okay. I have that. An envelope? The envelope was empty. Oh. This house is amazing, far beyond my wildest dreams. Jerry's efforts have truly exceeded my expectations. I better get acquainted right away. Jerry says the electrician should be on his way to solve the lights problem. I feel relieved. It seems the house is out of power. You can't have everything, I guess. Hopefully it's just a minor glitch, But I should tell Jerry. I guess this is not really in order that makes sense. I am speechless. I just read an incredible story about a mysterious African tribe. The personal memories of this James Blackwood person, even if it isn't true, it's simply terrific material. Judging by the stuff I've been seeing around, this Blackwood was really into African culture. Did I see this one? No. I've taken that. Letter opener? It looked like a boring tool. Oh, okay. It was locked. Key didn't fit there. Well, bit longer episode than I intended. Can I look? Oh, stop moving. Yo! I just want to finish looking at whatever's in this room. I'm looking at the ceiling? Oh. Okay. Yeah, look at that. Okay. Okay, most episodes won't be this long, but I'm going to call it an episode here. I got caught up in reading all this stuff. Thanks so much for watching, guys. See you in the next episode, and always seek adventure.